Welcome back to Fuel for Your Spiritual Fire. This is Tiffany Aitken, worship leader at Harrisburg Life Center. Amazing gifted ministry, but she's so much more than a worship leader. She's just a worshiper. You can't watch her worshiping the Lord without being completely swept up into your own love relationship with God. And she just kind of disappears and takes you there. And it's amazing. But she had a life-death experience where she coded twice. Was miraculously raised from the dead. And so I thought you would enjoy hearing her story. Tiffany, what happened the day you died?
The day I died? It was a Monday morning and we were out for a walk and I was fine. Up until this point, I had no symptoms of anything going wrong, nothing remotely even wrong with me. And we were out and it was a nice morning and we were finally, it was after the birth of our third child, which was our first son. And so it was like 2.5 months after he was born. So we were out getting some exercise and some fresh air and I left them at the park. I left my husband and two kids at the park and I walked on this trail that's by our house. And when we got back together and decided to walk home, my two-year-old at the time was like, Mom, can you hold me? I don't want to walk, you know? And I said, okay, I'll carry you to that tree. And I pointed at a tree like 50 yards away and then she would have to walk from there on. And so once I got to the tree, just all of a sudden, something changed inside of me and I looked at my husband and I said, John, something's not right. And in that moment, I just sat down on the ground and I laid back and passed out on the sidewalk and went into a seizure.
Okay.
And so, but I mean, he didn't know what was wrong. He just rushed to my side, called 911. And I came to and he actually hung up the phone on 911. They must have just answered because they immediately called him back and said, sir, what's the problem? We received a phone call from this number. And so at that point, everyone is on alert, fire, police, ambulance, everything is on alert. And so he said, oh, my wife just passed out. She's having trouble breathing. And so they sent the ambulance right away.
That was the wisdom of God that he called 911.
Right. So, because that had never happened to me before. I've never blacked out or went into a seizure or anything, you know. And so he was like, this isn't good. So they're on their way. And he can hear them coming, but I had passed out and gone into seizure two more times. And by the third time, he could hear them. They're rounding the corner, but I'm turning blue and he's freaking out. And the guy is on the phone with him, telling him, you know, calmly, you know, do all these things. And he's just a mess, like shouting my name and slapping my face. And so finally the EMTs arrive and assess the situation and literally just scoop me up and take me without even a word to him of what's happening or where they're taking me. And so he's got three kids and they're like five blocks from home and the ambulance just zooms off. And so he makes his way home and I'm on the way to the hospital, and in the ambulance I can remember the EMTs were asking me like, have you changed anything? Because they knew like I just had a newborn baby, and so I think they thought that I was like crash dieting or something and I just wasn't getting enough. And I wasn't, like I had stopped eating gluten and that was the biggest change that I made. Uh-huh. But I just said, I can't breathe. Like I felt like I was having a panic attack. Like I just can't draw enough breath to satisfy that need for air, you know?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, they had me on the oxygen and everything, but the EMT had seen the symptoms of blood clots, because he said the one vein was sticking out like far enough that he could tell like there was a blockage somewhere, but he didn't know how big or where, and so he just began to give me blood thinners.
And that was another divine thing,
yeah,
that he kind of recognized.
Yeah, because the nurses said, there's no way you can tell that there's a blood clot.
Oh my word.
And he was like,
oh my word,
I certainly can.
Thank you, God.
Yeah, wow. Everything was so laid out. Like, it's amazing. God was in every moment of it. And so he started to do the blood thinners, and so we get to like two blocks from the hospital and I coded in the ambulance. And so he did CPR and resuscitated me the first time. And I think they said that was about like 30 seconds that I coded. And so we get to the ER and they're wheeling me from the ambulance into the ER. And the admitting nurse said, she took a look at me on the gurney and she said, you look like a normal, you know, normal patient or whatever. She looked away and looked back and I was blue. Mm. And so at that time I had coded again, but I wasn't even connected to anything, any monitor at the time. Mm. And so they were like scrambling to get me in the room and go ahead and do CPR again, with the paddles and everything. And so it was, I think they estimated probably about 3 minutes that I had coded for. And so from that point, then you don't know how much recovery there will be of mental capacities and everything.
If any at all,
Exactly. And so they had to stabilize me. They ended up putting me in a medical coma to go ahead and take me in to do a CAT scan, and saw that the clots were in the pulmonary artery. It's the artery that connects both lungs. And so I had 20% of one lung working when I went into the ER. And my heart was enlarged. The one side of my heart was enlarged because of the extra blood that had nowhere to go.
Oh, my word.
And so when they saw the clots, you know, at that point, I think John had made it in, got someone to watch the kids and came into the hospital, and the cardiac surgeon who was available on a Monday morning.
Thank you, God.
You know, 12 o'clock on a Monday. So he comes in and says, John, we can't operate on her. She's full of this blood thinner. She'll bleed out on the table. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to let the blood thinners do their work. You know, it's a fairly large clot, but we're going to let them do their work, and then we'll go from there. And he said probably about 10 minutes had passed, and they came in and told him, we're going to take her to the OR. It's in his mind, it was either here or there. The operating room. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, they were going to take me to the operating room. So they went and prepped me in the operating room to remove the clots, which is basically open heart surgery, but they put my heart on a bypass and then remove the clots from the pulmonary artery, which I never knew what blood clots, I never knew how big they were. I always thought like anything, because your veins are so small, you know, it was probably really small, but they were the size of, one was like this size. It was one all connected, but when they pulled them out, it was two. So one this size and then one that size, like 5 inches long. And so like that size and that size and the same width around as my thumb. So it was a saddle clot over the whole connecting artery.
And you said there was two. What was the terminology?
A double pulmonary embolism.
A double pulmonary embolism. And the statistics with that?
Well, 15% of all sudden deaths are from a pulmonary embolism, which is just a blood clot in your lungs.
Oh my.
And this was a double pulmonary embolism, so both lungs were clogged. And so to remove them, the statistics are 1 in 500,000 would survive.
Wow. And you didn't just survive.
Right.
But you're perfect.
Yeah, so I came back like completely, like no deficit at all, nothing. And we got to go in a year later to just to do the recording for the 700 Club, and the people in the ER just wept when they saw me, because they don't know. Once you leave the ER, they have no idea what happened to you. So to see me walk in there, they were just in tears. And so it's really amazing and miraculous, like, 24 hours later, it was such a different story.
And you said so many people were praying
for you. So many people were praying. Yeah, I remember, so that happened Monday. So Tuesday afternoon, John knew it was crucial for all of the pastors from here to be there and pray for me in the ICU. Mm. And so it was, you know, post-surgery, 24 hours post-surgery, and I had still been in a medically induced coma. And so they all came in to pray in the hospital room, and they said they were praying for quite some time, and then they had Ricardo sing. So he started to sing Come To Me, Jen Johnson's Come To Me song. And when that happened, I actually remember I opened my eyes at that point, and I could see him, you know, through that fuzz that's like, I could see him and I could hear him singing, and they said they saw a tear form in my eye. So I wasn't like fully awake yet, but I remember that moment when he started singing, and I just felt such a comfort and such a peace that I knew God had like taken care of me, and I was gonna be okay, and it was just incredible. And from that point on, from the point that they prayed, like the next few days and even hours, like in a couple of hours I came off the breathing tube. The next, I think it was like 2 or 3 days later, the neurologist was like, I don't need to see her anymore, she's fine.
Oh my word.
Using my iPhone.
Oh my word.
So the recovery was just supernatural. They said, like John asked him right after the surgery, how long can we expect that she'll be in here, you know? And he said, oh, minimum 10 to 14 days, like the recovery time. And I was home that next Monday.
Oh, praise God.
So it was incredible, like just supernatural life.
Was your strength there for picking up your babies and doing your normal
hustle? Not immediately.
Okay.
To overcome that surgery, you know, basically open heart surgery, I couldn't lift. I think it was a good 6 weeks before I could lift my baby.
Okay.
And a gradual. They said by 3 months I should be able to play rugby if I needed to.
Okay, okay.
So it was definitely a slow healing process in terms of coming back to my full self, and even my voice, because of the breathing tube, like everything happened so quickly, they just shoved it in there and did all that. But it took a while for me to recover the ability to actually sing again, and so it was weak. I had such a weak voice for a while, but it's all come back, and It's miraculous.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. Is there anything that you want to say to those who are watching to encourage them to trust God through difficult physical situations?
Yes, I fully believe that there is absolutely nothing that is impossible for God. He's for us, and I mean, I've experienced it so much, and even like wrote songs about it before anything happened. I wrote this song called "You're the God of the Impossible," or it's "He is Able," but you know, it's off the scripture Ephesians 3:22. He can do exceedingly and abundantly far more than we could ever ask or imagine. And then the chorus in that song is, "You're the God of the impossible." And then we walk into this impossible situation where I shouldn't have made it, and I did. So it's like, the word of the Lord is strong and it's powerful, and His Spirit is alive inside of us. And so it's like we need to just grab hold of that and believe in the smallest and in the biggest circumstances that He can change it for our better. And so it's just amazing. My kids are amazing.
And He did. He didn't just raise you back to life.
Right.
But He used your testimony now to propel your testimony and the way you glorify God to the ends of the earth.
Yeah.
Through TV and media and opportunities to share that.
Yes.
God's just opened doors and greatly enriched your fruitfulness in Him through, you know, what the devil would cause for your harm. God totally turned around for His glory.
So true. Yeah, every aspect of it, we can see God's goodness in it. Mm-hmm. Every single aspect. I'm like, just the right person at the right place at the right time. And we were right there.
It. Mm-hmm.
It was amazing. Like,
praise
just amazing.
Lord.
So
thank you so much for sharing.
You're
I really appreciate
that.
Okay, thanks for watching. Bye-bye.